Thank you, brother. I love listening to your music on Sabbath morning. I always enjoy Roger's compositions. For those of you that don't know, Roger composes a lot of that on the fly as he's playing, and I always enjoy listening to his improvisations on the piano. Welcome to church, everyone. Happy Sabbath. My name is Dan Thorward, and I'm happy to say that I'm one of the elders here at the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. Welcome to worship this morning. We're glad you're all here. We have just a few announcements to get started. In our first one, Miss Sandy is going to have a very special announcement for us today. And I think she's going to use this mic up here so that she can set it up. And she's got a very special announcement, so we'll take it away. It's interactive.
Hi. Happy Sabbath. It's so good to see you. I've seen so many smiling faces today. Some weeks you come in and it's all kind of grumpy and yucky, but today everybody's smiling. I don't know if it has anything to do with the old year passing and a new year ahead, but that's what I'm up here about. I'm welcoming all of you and as many of your families as you want to bring. Friends, instead of going to that New Year's Eve party that usually starts late and then ends about midnight, well, we're having one here. It begins at 6:30 to 7:30.
Huh? Hey,
what?
I heard, I saw you 2 weeks ago. And the last time I saw you, you were just listening to a box.
Oh, you didn't listen well. Or maybe I didn't listen well. It was, I had a bag. So I guess I'll explain it to you. What this gentleman, thank you for bringing this to my attention, is talking about is I had a bag here, which represented a small Christmas bag that represented 2016. So I put that aside. Then I had a box in this hand, and I kept hearing music in it. I kept hearing voices in it. I kept hearing stuff in it, and laughter, and joy, and everything. To me, everybody should have understood that was representing the new year and the things that were going to happen in it. So that's what tonight's happening. And the reason it's called a gathering, because I know that's what you're going to ask me next, is I am gathering you all here for, okay, thank you. Thank you. It felt weird too. We're having a gathering. It's starting at 6:30 and it lasts till 7:30. That's the program. And then we go down the hallway for an hour for refreshments. But the good thing and the special thing about this gathering is it encompasses so much. It's encompassing love and joy, special musics, happiness, prayer time, a speaker. We are all going to be speaking. We're all going to be singing. And there's just so much goodness about being together on the eve of a new year, especially when it involves the church and church family and friends that you bring. It's fun. It's joyous. And it just gives you so much goodness to think about what is next year going to be like. It's got to be better. God is closer, and we are closer to going, too. Thank you. Be here, 6:30.
Thank you to Sandy and to Phil for their interactive announcement. That went very well, Sandy. For those of you that, please.
Big part of, this is a new thing for me. The children collected for their Christmas time play. They collected foods for the food bank. So I called and I asked, what can we do for you? Well, they need toiletries.
What?
Toiletries.
What's that?
That's stuff that makes you smell pretty so people can sit around you. Everything, anything that you use, shampoo, soap, conditioners, toothbrushes, toothpaste, razors for you gentlemen, baby powder, baby soap, baby everything, anything in toiletry line, please bring. There's a box that is decorated outside. It'll be close to the door. Pour it all in there. Make it full. And then we're going to take that to them. They say that is one of the things that they get very little of. They get more food, than toiletries, Phil. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Sandy. Sandy is our prayer coordinator, and tonight's Vespers, she has pulled together for us to celebrate the end of the year. We're very excited. I will be there, and I will bring some toiletries to donate, so I'm very excited about that. Next up, we have our favorite Aunt Marge, our co-director with me for our health ministries, and we have a couple of important things for you to think about for 2017 where it comes to our health ministries.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank all of you who volunteered to help us out at the Worthington Mall on the 12th. One little change. They've changed the hours. I found this out yesterday. The hours for the health screening at the Worthington Mall on Thursday, January the 12th, the hours are 12 to 6. So if you signed up with me and we haven't already talked, if you want to change anything, let me know, but please don't come at 9 o'clock unless you just want to shop. Okay, the other thing is, the last week or two we've been singing about our Savior's birth. Yes? I would proposition that our Savior came to this earth for multiple reasons. Being our Savior is one. Another reason, though, was to show us how to live. How to live a healthy life, how to live with joy and happiness. And I just want to invite you all, if you're having any problems in your life, particularly physical problems, blood pressure, stroke, heart disease, cholesterol, diabetes, things like that, I would invite you to please consider coming to our CHIP seminar. Probably many of you who are new have never heard of CHIP. Next week, we're going to have an information video about it on the 15th of January at 3 o'clock. That's a Sunday. We're going to have an information session in the fellowship hall. And our seminar is going to start on January the 23rd. There is a note about it in your bulletin. We'll be revising it next week to add some of these dates. But just a reminder, we have received a grant so that the first five members from our church will have a $100 discount to come to the program. So please think about how you or your loved ones or your friends can start off the new year in a healthy way, looking forward maybe to better healthy days than you've had for a while.
I know I really appreciate Marge's work on the health ministry. Lots of exciting things coming in 2017, including the 10TV Health and Fitness Expo, which will be coming up shortly after these two events. So please keep that in the back of your minds as well, because at full capacity, we can see up to 800 people in 2 days and screen them for cholesterol and blood pressure and many other things, and we need your help to be able to do that. So it's a very important ministry to this church and to our community, so please keep those things in mind. Once again, I'd like to remind everybody, as Bobby would say, that we are here at 385 East Double Granville Road here at Worthington, and we're welcoming all of you to worship with us today. Those of you watching online and at home, welcome, and at this time, I'm going to invite our song leader to join us up in front, and we're going to begin with our opening hymn.
Good morning, Happy New Year. Would you stand with me? And our hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's on the screen, and it's also hymn 100. We have a nice gathering today. I expect you to really sing with me.
They fail not, as thou hast merely sing it out. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Ladies only on the second stanza. Let me hear you, ladies. Everyone now.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Men only.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thy own near presence, their mercy to guide. Strength for today and no strength for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside.
Everyone now, sing it out.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided.
Three times.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Please be seated.
It's time for our morning prayer. Wherever able, please kneel with me for prayer this morning. Father in heaven, we come together here as a Worthington Church family at the end of 2016. We know that your peace and your guidance has led us this far, and we know that you will not forsake us, and you will lead us safely forward through 2017 until the day that you return to take us home. Lord, I pray for our church leaders, our leaders of our nation and our world leaders, Lord. I pray that you would guide their hearts and minds and lead us in a way that would bring us closer to you, in a way closer to more peace and more prosperity, Lord. We know that there are so many brothers and sisters of ours today worshiping in places where if they were found, would be persecuted for their faith. We are so lucky and privileged to worship today in a place and in a country that allows us to express our faith as we believe we should, Lord. Coming together on Sabbath morning, singing and praying, and thanking you for all of your mercies. Thank you for our church family. Thank you for our church leadership, Lord. I pray a special blessing today on Bobby as he begins his transition in 2017 from our church to his new pastorship in Arizona. I pray that you would bless his congregants and his church. May it grow and may his ministry bring many more into the fold, Lord, before your return. Thank you for a chance for our church to grow as well. We are very excited for our future here and so grateful for the way you've led us. I pray a special blessing this morning on those who cannot be with us, those that are sick or at home or are traveling, those that are watching us right now at home. I pray that you would help them feel a special Sabbath blessing. Help them to realize that they are just as much a part of our congregation this morning as those of us that are here in Worthington. Thank you for all the gifts you've given us. I pray that you would give us a special blessing for being here as we finish this year, 2016, and look forward to 2017, Lord. May this be the year that you return to take us home.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'll ask the deacons and ushers to come forward at this time to collect our tithes and offerings. As you all know, toward the end of the year, we always have a special Christmas club collection. You might still see a few of those special Christmas envelopes in front of you in the pews. Please know that those monies are a special contribution to help our finances at the end of the year. All of those monies collected are going to go directly to our local church budget to support our local ministries and also support in a special way our daycare ministry and its continued ministry here in Worthington. I want to just ask a quick word on our tithes and offerings, so those, please bow your heads with me, and we'll quickly bless our tithes and offerings. Father in heaven, thank you so much for a chance to give back just a piece of what you've given to us. We know that you don't need our tithes and offerings to accomplish your work, Lord, but we know that you've asked us to give for our needs, because we need to recognize you as sovereign of all things, that you, through us, can accomplish your will. And that if we want to be a part, as we gladly choose to give back a little bit of what you've given to us, I pray that you would bless it and use it to help strengthen your ministries here and around the world. Amen. Yes. Just a quick word. There will be an update on how our finances have finished the year, especially where it comes to our Christmas club next week. And our treasurer and our finance director will be up to share that with you at that time. Amen. Thank you.
our group assembles. Someone made that name on us. We're not the bluegrass chorale. We're not going to sing anything like I'm not crying because you're getting ready to go. I'm crying because you're standing on my toe. None of our songs won't be anything like that. We don't have an official name yet. I wanted to use Three Bees and a Honey, but someone said that won't work in church. This song is one of the songs that I hear as I'm traveling in the morning to go to various places to work. I listen to the radio station WEEC, and there are some beautiful, beautiful songs. And this is one of them. We've practiced it a long time, and we hope that you like it. It's called Sometimes It Takes a Mountain. Now, understand, there is a pause in the middle of the song. It doesn't mean it's over. Be patient, because it changes keys, and you'll know when it's over. So listen to us, pay attention. We hope that you like it.
I've faced a mountain that I've never faced before. That's why I'm calling on you, Lord. I know it's been a while, but Lord, please hear my prayer. I need you like I never have before. Sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert to get a hold of me. Your love is so much stronger than whatever troubles me. Sometimes it takes a mountain to trust you and believe.
Forgive me, Jesus. I thought I could control whatever life would throw my way. But this I will admit has brought me to my knees. I need you, Lord, and I'm not ashamed to say.
Sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert to get a hold. Love is so much stronger than whatever troubles me. Sometimes it takes a mountain,
oh Lord,
to trust you and believe. Sometimes it takes a mountain to trust you and believe.
troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert, oh, to get a hold of me. Your love is so much stronger than whatever troubles me. Sometimes it takes a mountain to trust you and believe. Sometimes it takes a mountain to trust you.
Just for a moment. Father in heaven, thank you so much for a chance to be here this morning. I pray that you would guide my words. May they be yours and not mine alone. I pray that you would calm my heart and my speech so that I can articulate the message you've given me to share today. Amen. Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. It's our last Sabbath together here before the new year, and I have to tell you that I was not necessarily planning on preaching today. But as you all know, Pastor Bob had a death in his wife's family. I believe it was her father that passed away, was it not, Carolyn? And I think he's officiating the service today out west. So our thoughts and prayers are with him. But I was happy to have the opportunity to step up to share a few thoughts today. Now, often when I'm sitting where you're sitting and I'm listening to Julian preach, occasionally I'll have a thought and I'll just sort of jot it down on a postcard and stick it in my Bible. And occasionally those thoughts eventually turn into sermon titles. I had not originally planned to preach this sort of as an end of the year sermon, but I thought about it, and I think that there are some things that I want to share today that I think will help us refocus ourselves in 2017. I chose a verse for today, and it comes from Matthew, and I think that it's one that is real important to me. I tell you truly, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me. If we want to be real missionaries for Christ, the people that God has for us to talk to on a daily basis is our mission field. You don't have to get on a plane and fly to South America or to Africa or to Asia or to Europe to be a missionary. Sometimes I think that it's easier for us to be missionaries to people we don't know than it is for us to be missionaries to the people we see every day in our lives. I think that what God's telling us here is that the people around you, how you treat them, with kindness, respect, dignity, and love, the way God would have you treat them, when you do that, you're teaching them and showing them the character of God. And that's how you can be a missionary, and that's how you can brighten the corner right where you are, right here in Worthington. So I think the question I want to start with today is, where are we? Where are you? Where do you find yourself day in and day out at work and at church and at school? Because that's the corner that God has asked you to brighten. I believe that God has you right where he wants you today, right now, for you to be an instrument for him. And I think that if you look around you, you'll see opportunities that you can use your gifts and talents to minister to those around you. And I think in 2017, we should think about recommitting ourselves to those things. Our passions, the talents that God gave you, the things that you are invested in, are the very things that he wants you to use to minister to those around you. So what kind of church member would God have you be this year? Would he have you be someone who shows up and just sort of phones in your performance every week, or does he want you to be something more than that? Now, I have to tell you the truth. The verse that I opened with in Matthew wasn't originally the verse I thought would best fit the sermon today. The one that I chose isn't quite as happy, as friendly as the verse I chose. But let's take a quick look at Revelation, because I'm going to talk to you today about several churches. And not the church in Philadelphia, not the church in Laodicea, but three churches that I've been to: Worthington, Pioneer Memorial Church, and the Sitka Seventh-day Adventist Church in Sitka, Alaska. I'm an elder, not a pastor, and I don't know that I'm trained enough to speak about the Church of Laodicea and the Church of Philadelphia in here, but I do think that I have some insights from the churches that I've attended in my life that I think we can tie together to share the point that this verse brings out. Let's take a look at Revelation. This is the third chapter, and I want to start with verse 15 and read verse 15 and 16. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were either one. So because you are lukewarm, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Those are the words that the Lord gave to the church at Laodicea. Now, I am not a theologian, and I can't unpack all that for you, but I can tell you that there's a message there for us today. Because God doesn't want us to show up and phone in our performance. One of the things that used to strike me when I was a young person in high school was all of the hours, and some of you knew me then in those years, I did a lot of theater. A lot of theater when I was in high school and college. And I would spend hours and hours and hours focused on every nuance of every phrase and every syllable spoken on stage. And it always struck me as an irony that when I would come to church, something that was so much more important than what I was doing in the theater, that we would just sort of show up and do our thing and it was good enough. I really think that God wants us to be able to, not just in terms of worship, but in terms of our daily interaction with others, step up and try to provide more than just sort of phoning it in. And I think that's what this verse is talking about. I think God is saying, if you're going to just show up, that's fine. But what I'm really looking for are passionate Christians who want to share my word with those around them through their life and through the actions of their life. We're going to circle back to that. Now, remember, I'm not going to talk about the church we just read about, the Church of Laodicea. I don't know much about that church. I do know a little bit about some of these churches because I attended them in my life. Pioneer Memorial Church, Sitka Seventh-day Adventist Church, and right here in the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. This is Pioneer Memorial. How many of you have been to Pioneer Memorial Church? Probably at least half of our congregation today has been to Pioneer Memorial Church. It's a very large sanctuary. It seats, I think, about 3,000 folks. I don't know what our capacity is. Anybody know what our capacity in here is? 200? 300? Something like that? But this church can seat 3,000 comfortably. And then there's overflow seating in some of the other chapels where they can stream the service up so other people can be there. When the Net 98 crusade took place, it took place in this church that was broadcast around the world. It's a big church. I remember when I was a freshman in college stepping onto the campus of Andrews, I remember walking into this church, and I at that time I was a voice major. I was for a couple of years on a scholarship there. And I remember standing up in front the first time I led praise singing at that church with all those people and TV cameras and the service going out on the radio. And I was so intimidated by that space. But I can tell you that as time went on, I got more and more comfortable in this huge, massive church. What stuck with me, though, wasn't the size and scale of PMC. What I remember taking away from it was that there were so many volunteers and so many people in attendance there, which is wonderful, that it was very easy for me just to show up and sit and enjoy the service and then go home. If I didn't show up any given Sabbath, if I wasn't singing or on the platform, there was still going to be church, there was still going to be Sabbath school, there was still going to be a mission spotlight, and all those things would happen regardless of my attendance. It's very easy in a large congregation to feel like your voice doesn't matter or that you don't have a calling in that church because there's so many people volunteering and doing things. And I think that's a pitfall of a church that size sometimes, is that it's easy to feel like you don't have a part to play when you do. I want to contrast that now with Sitka. Sitka Seventh-day Adventist Church sits in a town of about 9,000 people there in Sitka, Alaska. I could ask for a show of hands of folks that have worshipped there, but I think that there's about five of us that have worshipped there. And I should take a quick time to say thank you to Faith and the Babcock family who've been watching Palmer for me this morning while I was preaching. So thank you for that. And I say that because they recently were worshiping in the Sitka Church with my family just a few weeks ago. The Sitka Church seats probably about 35, 40 people comfortably. And on any given Sabbath, there's probably about 10 or 15 folks who come, give or take. Sometimes more, sometimes less. The first time I took Palmer to Sabbath school there, Sabbath school was Palmer, my four-month-old son, myself, and my mom. That was cradle roll, and that was juniors and kindergarten and early teen. It was the whole thing, just the three of us. If my folks don't show up any given Sabbath, there may not be a sermon, there may not be Sabbath school, there may not be an offering call, because every single person who attends that church has a role to play that day. Someone has to call for the offering. Someone does like a mission spotlight and talks about cares and concerns of the church family. Someone does a children's story. And every single person who attends, for the most part, has a part to play. And many Sabbaths, you show up, you don't even know what you're going to be doing when you get there, but by the time service starts, you may be volunteered to give a special music or share a story of faith. Very, very different experience between this church and this one. And that takes us to the third church we're going to talk about this morning, Worthington. Worthington is not nearly the size of PMC, but it is so much larger than Sitka. It's easy in a church this size to feel like you're not needed, because there are enough people here that there is still going to be Sabbath school if you don't come, and there is still going to be a special music if you don't attend. But it's a dangerous thing to think that the Lord doesn't want you to serve. He does. He wants you to feel like this is your family. Now, I know that we've got visitors here today. Worthington may not be your home church, but I would challenge you that wherever your home church is, that you have a part to play, and that God has a plan for you to play a part in that church, more than just attending. In 2017, I believe that what God wants from us is to be a Seventh-day Adventist Christian 7 days of the week, not just on Sabbath, but every day. I believe that every day we go to work, every day we go to school, He wants us to share His love with other people. Now, I don't know how you feel, and you may disagree with me about this, but I have found in my experience that the people that I've been able to lead closer to God came from an example of Christ's love in my life, or in the life of lives of people around me, more so than it did for me showing up and saying, you know, you may be Episcopalian, or you may be a Catholic or a Baptist, and look at these little differences in eschatology between me and you, and you should probably come to my church because we've got the writings right, and you don't. When people come to church with me, it's usually because I'm a good friend to them. I try to treat them with respect and dignity and love the same way that I think God would want me to treat them. And those are the people who tend to come to church with me, not the ones who I tell, you know, if you don't join my church, you know, God save your soul. And that's something that I've learned. So in my life this year, that's what I want to do. I want to be a Christian who shares God's love to the people around me by treating them with respect and dignity. The last bullet point there is, I think we should all find a way to get involved this year. You don't have to do everything. You don't have to be on every committee, on every board, but there are committees and boards and ministries that need your help here. And wherever you attend regularly, God wants you to be involved in the ministries of His church. These are just a few things that came to my mind last night when I was typing up my sermon. Right now, I can tell you that we need church Sabbath school teachers. We need choir members, especially folks who sing alto and tenor. Those are two areas the choir really could use some more choir members. Health ministries. We have health ministry events that happen all year long, and we need people that can welcome people and shake their hand, all the way up to people who can do cholesterol screenings. We need people to show up on Sunday mornings and make sandwiches. Is everyone aware that every Sunday morning, that right here at our church, people get together and volunteer to make sandwiches for the homeless in Columbus every Sunday morning? All you have to do to be a part of that ministry is show up on Sunday morning and be willing to make sandwiches. Pathfinders and adventurers, leaders for our young people, deacons and deaconesses. School and daycare volunteers. We have a very active school and a very active daycare. And those ministries right on this campus could use your expertise. They could use you to come in and read to a class or help the teachers with their curriculum or grading. And there's so many things that you could do to get involved and be a part of the ministry here in Worthington. I noticed today in our bulletin that we're still looking for someone to be a full-time paid employee to help take care of the maintenance of our campus. That person can't do it alone. There's still lots of volunteers needed to help maintain and keep our buildings up to code and everything running smoothly. So as I think about sort of summarizing these different thoughts that I had this week, I want to sort of kind of put them in a frame that is a New Year's resolution for me. First, I want to be the example that I want to see in others. Christ told me to remove the plank from my own eye before I tell you about the splinter in yours. So make sure that you're looking to yourself first and treating other people the way you would want to be treated. It's very difficult for someone to, in good faith, come to somebody and say, look, you should be doing something differently if they themselves aren't doing it. So be the example that you want to see. Look to the example of Christ, not to man. I got to tell you, folks, I don't know how much faith you put in the systems of this earth, but I can tell you that in the end, they will all fail. There is no government, there is no king, there is no president or business leader who will ever ultimately be the kind of example that you need in your life. You need to look to God for that example. Men will let you down every time, eventually, because we are all human and sinful. Look to God, look to Jesus, and look to his example as the example for your life. This is one that I gotta tell you, this is the hardest one for me. Be less concerned about being right and more concerned about loving others. That's one that I struggle with, but it's what God is in his ministry on earth. That's what Jesus showed me he wants me to do. I need to be more concerned about loving others. Condemn not, right? Lest you be condemned. Be a citizen of heaven today. You don't have to wait till the Lord comes back to start living the life he wants you to have. I can tell you that in this world, nothing will ever be perfect, right? And I see every day in the intensive care unit where I work, people with very tragic circumstances and very tragic diseases that are taking their life away from them here on this earth. But for those of us that had enough strength today to get up, take a breath, have breakfast, and come to church, every single one of us is blessed just to be in this place right now and not stuck in a hospital on a ventilator. We are all blessed. And because we are that blessed, we are able to make decisions today to help us to live a better life. You don't have to wait. You can right now decide to start ministering to the people around you. You can start to forgive the people that you've held a grudge against. You can start choosing to eat better and be more active right now, today. You don't have to wait. And you can start that life that you want to have, that God wants you to have today. You don't have to wait. I want to say that I count it a privilege to be able to get up on occasion and preach here at Worthington. It's something that I really enjoy. We're going to transition now from our sermon into our communion. We're going to finish this year with a chance to celebrate God's love for us and remember his sacrifice. I'm going to ask our deacons and deaconesses to come up and prepare the elements. And as we do, I'd like to share with all of you or remind all of you that the Adventist Church does not practice closed communion. Anyone who is a believer in Jesus Christ may participate. You don't have to be a Seventh-day Adventist. So today, as we get ready to share the bread and the wine, please understand that all are welcome at the table, and all are welcome to join us here. For those of you that have not already, I would be remiss if I didn't also mention that our foot washing service for the Ordinance of Humility takes place in the Fellowship Hall. And I know that it usually is suspended during church service, but if you've not had a chance to have your feet washed today as a part of communion and you'd like to participate, I know that there are deacons and deaconesses who would still help facilitate that if possible. What we're going to do, folks, in order to get everyone the elements before we have communion, what we're going to do is all stand up and come down the aisle together, down the center, and collect the wine and the bread and then take it back to your seat. This helps us facilitate communion much, much more efficiently than when we pass out the elements. So we're going to ask our minister of music to play some music for us for the next few minutes, and I'd ask everyone just to stand up, come down the center aisle, and all are welcome to collect the bread and the wine, and then take it back to your seat. One of our elders just went upstairs to serve the balcony as well. So at this time, please come forward and receive the elements and take them back to your seats, and we'll share them together once everyone has been served. that if you don't feel like you can make it forward, there will be an elder or a deacon coming around to you after everyone's been served. So if you can't get up and walk down, don't feel like you won't be able to take the elements. We'll have an elder or deacon come to you with the elements after everyone's been served. If anybody else needs to be served, just raise your hand. If you weren't able to come forward, one of our deacons will come to you. Brothers and sisters, please bow your head with me and we'll ask a blessing on the elements. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the gift of your Son. At the end of this year, it is fitting that we remember that he gave his life so that we could live. He came, he suffered, he showed us an example of what it could be like to live in a kingdom where you are king. We wait anxiously for that day, Lord, when we can all live in that kingdom with you forever. Until that day, Lord, we will continue to, in the example that you gave us, to remember your sacrifice. Amen. While they were eating, Jesus took the bread and gave thanks and broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many." He said to them, "I tell you the truth, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine again until that day when I drink it with you in the kingdom of God." The Bible says that then those gathered together for that supper went out to finish with our closing hymn.
Stand. Let's everyone, before we sing, stand and look at each other and say, "I love you, Happy New Year," and then we'll sing it. Let's all do it together. Sing together. Do not wait until the time of perfect do. Do not fear to shed the light of life. Do the many duties over them wear a true bright in the corner where you are. Sing it out. Bright in the corner where you are. Bright in the corner where you are. Someone in an arbor, baby, down across the bar. Bright in the corner where you are. We end with the second stanza. Sing it out.
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you come to trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.